So realize that if your data is not accurate, if we can't trust it, it may as well not exist. Why do we bother having it? It means a lot of work to create it. So let's talk about what is data integrity. It's more than you may believe. It's the extent to which data is complete, consistent, and accurate throughout the data lifecycle, from the initial generation through recording and processing, including transformation of the data from manual to computer, from computer to another computer, to a backup, to a restore. Does it all hang together? Many companies I go to, I say, have you checked that the restore function works? You back up the data, great, but how do we know the file wasn't corrupted during the backup? And they say, no. Well, I say, well, let's do it now. Let's humor me. Let's try and restore the data now and come back at lunchtime and show me the restore data matches the original data. Lunchtime comes and goes, and they say, well, we're still trying to do it. Well, come on, it should be just a press of a button. Right through retention, archiving, retrieval, and finally destruction. Yes, eventually you will destroy the data. 10, 20 years from now, do you still need to keep the data? Probably not. So data sits in the middle of three circles. It's like a Venn diagram. Confidentiality, you don't want your data getting out to other people. Integrity, can we rely on the data? Is it integral? And is it available to review? That availability is often a big problem. The key to data integrity is what is called ALCOA. Everybody familiar with the term ALCOA? Aluminium Corporation of America, ALCOA? That's their logo. Okay. Just remember ALCOA. No, I don't have shares in ALCOA. And it's the key to data integrity. So what is this ALCOA? It's an acronym for five things. The A is attributable. You clearly know who recorded the data or who performed the activity. It's been signed and it's been dated, and you know who wrote the document and when they did it. Last year I was in India at an API company, and the batch records are in English. Nice, I can read it. And I'm looking at the batch record, the production cycle, the processing cycle, the reaction time is 48 hours at a certain temperature and pressure and rotation. And I'm looking at 48 hours worth of data, and it's all written with the same slope of the handwriting, the same color ink, and it's all exactly written down the middle of the column. What would you think to yourself? Is this written by the person who did the job when they did the job? Probably not. So I said to the QA director next to me, I said, you know, I don't believe that the actual operator wrote these details, because 48 hours is six shifts, each of 6 hours, and you can have six types of handwriting, but it's all one type of handwriting. And he goes, Mr. Anisfeld, you are totally correct. I said, then why doesn't the operator do it? And they said, well, the operator can't read or write. I said, okay, I can understand that. They don't read and write English. Why don't you write it in the local language, Marathi? This was outside Mumbai. Marathi. And he says, no, Mr. Anisfeld, you don't understand what I'm saying. The local operator can't read or write anything. Totally illiterate in any language. So we have to have the supervisors come in afterwards and write down what we think that happened. So there's your first basic problem of data integrity. Legible. It must be possible to read or interpret the data after it's recorded. It must be permanent. That means no pencils. No unexplained hieroglyphics or symbols or codes. And if it's corrected, it has to be done properly. You know, the proper way, one line through, signature date, new number. Or if in Japan, two lines through, because Japan is different. No, two line, if one line through in Japan, it means that not whatever it is, and two lines through means it's an error. Has to be contemporaneous. The data has to be recorded at the time it was generated in close proximity to the location where the data is generated. So I went to one company where the balances are three rooms away down the corridor, and they go along to do the weighing, and they remember what the weighing is, they come back three rooms, they write it down. Not exactly the best practice. Original. The data has to be preserved in an unaltered state. If not, you have to explain why not, and you have to certify copies of the data. In France, it is terrible. There is a cultural thing there. Don't ask me why it is, but it's a cultural thing. You want the data in reports to be neat and typed and legible. So they do that. They take the original data, they copy it into the typist, and she types it up all neatly and legible, and then they throw away the original. Don't ask me why. I see that even this year I saw that. And lastly, it has to be accurate, has to correctly reflect the action or the observation made. The data has to be checked where necessary, and modifications have to be explained if they are not evident. So, the data has to be checked where necessary. That doesn't mean every piece of data has to be checked. There are what we call critical data elements and non-critical data elements. So if I'm recording your training, there are critical elements of the training. What was the topic? Who gave it? When was it given? What is not critical is the exact time it started to the second and the exact time it finished to the second. So that's critical, non-critical. And there are many documents we have in our industry that really are not critical and don't need a second signature. I go some places where everything has a second signature. And the amount of manpower that takes and the amount of checking and rechecking is incredible. So first look at your data and say, what is critical and what is not critical?